Hello everyone, welcome to the Academia series. I'm coming your way with the second session under the topic light energy. Before I proceed, please remember to subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss any post from me. And if you have any comment or any question to ask, you can contact me through the email address displayed on your screen, or you can also comment on the comment section under my channel. Alright, so my last session under the topic light, I presented something on rectilinear propagation of light and then the operation of the pinhole camera. Today we are going to look at a lesson that will help us to explain how shadows are formed and describe how solar and lunar eclipses are also formed. So at the end of the lesson, I expect learners to explain how shadows are formed and also describe how solar and lunar eclipses are formed. Now let's start with shadows. On a sunny day, you can witness a shadow of you being cast on the ground. Or I would like to say a lot of you have seen shadows being formed on screens. A shadow is an area of darkness cast on a screen by an opaque object. Remember, I gave you three categories of substances or objects in relation to light rays. Some of them will allow light rays to pass through them and we call them transparent. Some will allow some of the light rays to pass through, whilst they will reflect or absorb the rest, and we call them the translucent objects. And the last one, which we term as opaque, they will not allow any light rays to pass through. In fact, it is opaque objects that forms shadow when they meet light rays. For example, the sun casts our shadows on the ground. This is because our bodies are opaque and they do not allow sun rays to pass through. So the sun becomes our source of light. Our bodies become the opaque body, and then the ground becomes the screen on which the shadow is formed. We have two types of shadows. We have the umbra and the penumbra shadow. Now, for the umbra shadow, is the total shadow cast by an opaque object. If I say total shadow, I will explain what I mean by that. It is produced from a point source of light. Now let's consider the diagram here. If I say point, I mean tiny source of light. So here I'm using the torchlight to represent my point source of light. And if this red image here is being taken as the opaque object, it casts a shadow. It casts a shadow on the screen here. And this type of shadow is called the umbra type of shadow. Very dark in appearance. And remember, if it is coming from a point source, we only consider two rays. Please be mindful of the diagram. Then we have the penumbra shadow, which is a partial shadow that usually surrounds an umbra shadow cast by an opaque object. It is produced by an extended source of light. What I mean by extended source of light is that the opening or the source of light is larger as compared with that of the umbra, which is point source. And in this case, for the extended source, we consider a number of rays. So if you compare here, we have only two rays, but if you come here, we are dealing with four rays. Let's trace them. This one comes from the top and then pass through the down part of the aim object, or the pick object, and then finally incident here. This one comes from the down part, pass through the top here, and then also incident here. And then we have also an array coming from here straight away, it doesn't change direction, then gets here, and another array pass through here, it doesn't change any direction with respect to the object, comes here. These two forms the umbra, and then those two ways that exchange direction forms the penumbra. And the penumbra type of shadow is not as dark as the umbra, so it is always formed around the edges of the umbra. If you look at this diagram here, from the point source we have the umbra type of shadow being formed here, but for the extended source, as you can see, we have the umbra in the middle and then the penumbra being formed around it. Please be mindful of the rays. Two, one here pass through the top straight away to form the umbra, here two from the down straight away join this one here to form the umbra shadow. But those that exchange directions with respect to the object forms the penumbra type of shadow. Let's continue. In the formation of shadow, one application of it is the formation of eclipse, a natural phenomenon. Eclipse is the total or the partial disappearance of the sun or the moon from Earth. That is, if you are on the Earth and eclipse should occur, you may at a point in time not see the sun or the moon. It is caused by either the Earth or the moon blocking light rays, usually from the sun, from reaching the moon or the Earth, depending on which of them gets into the sun's rays. There are two types of eclipse. We have the eclipse of the sun, which we can also term as solar eclipse, and we have the eclipse of the moon, which we can also call the lunar eclipse. Let's take the eclipse of the sun or solar eclipse. This is a real picture depicting or showing a total darkness caused by the moon blocking the sun rays. So here is a picture of the solar eclipse. It occurs when the moon comes between the sun and the Earth. So here I will use the acronym SME. S for sun, M for moon, E for Earth. So always the moon is between the sun and then the Earth. This type of eclipse produces both the umbra and then the penumbra shadow, and usually occurs during the day. Let's look at this diagram also here. So once again, we have the moon. Look at the size, a little bit smaller compared to the Earth. So let's look at it carefully. It casts a small shadow of umbra over a small area, and then a little bit larger penumbra shadows also over a certain area on the Earth. So bear in mind that the umbra shadow here covers a smaller area. Also, the penumbra also covers somehow a little bit larger area. Why is the shadows smaller here? This is because of the small size of the moon. We will compare it to lunar eclipse and see the how larger the penumbra and then the umbra is. So, as I said, the moon always comes between the sun and then the Earth. Now there's another diagram here to depict what I'm trying to show. So people who are in this area here will experience total darkness, and then those who will be here in the penumbra region will experience darkness, but as not as dark as those in the umbra region. Those around here will not experience any eclipse because they will receive the sun rays. Let's quickly watch this video to illustrate my point on solar eclipse. All right. So as I said, the moon is orbiting around the Earth, and the Earth is also orbiting around the sun. So at a point in time, these bodies become linear, or at a point in time, they are all find themselves in a straight line. The point in time, they all find themselves in a straight line. Let me go back here. They all find themselves in a straight line. And that's where solar eclipse forms. So at a point in time, they all find themselves in a straight line. And that's where solar eclipse will be formed. So let's see what I mean by that. Okay. So here, as you can see, they are all in line. And then we have the umbra shadow being cast here. And then we have the penumbra shadow also being cast around the umbra. All right. Now, let's also remember that. Let's also remember that as the solar eclipse is being formed, we have some kind of shadows or some kind of appearance you may see from the sun. Here is the start of the eclipse when the moon is blocking the sun rays. So we see part of the sun is gone. And then as the moon moves into the path of the sun's ray, it blocks it. So we see that the sh area of the sun has begin to decrease. Here it has further decreased until it covers the whole sun. So that some people in some area will see the sun totally dark. And then as it begins to move away, the sun rays appear again until it finally leave off. And then we see our full sun again. So that's that on solar eclipse. Now let's start on lunar eclipse. For lunar eclipse, it is also called eclipse of the moon. It occurs when the Earth comes between the sun and the moon in a straight line. So once again, we have sun, Earth, and then the moon. Now let's look at this carefully. Compared with solar eclipse, where the moon was rather in the middle, right now the Earth is rather in the middle, and then due to the size of the Earth, it creates a larger or a wider umbra and penumbra. A wider umbra and penumbra. Therefore, we realize that the whole moon or the moon is totally covered in the umbra region. Now, let's say it starts from here. The shadow starts from here on the moon. Because of the wide nature of the shadow, it will take a long period of time before it gets out of the shadow. So we say that the duration for the lunar eclipse is longer compared to that of the solar eclipse. Let's go back to the solar eclipse diagram and check. You see, this one covers as the moon moves faster, so it's able to get away from the shadows or able to get away from the rays quickly than compared with the lunar eclipse. So we are saying that for here, the duration for solar eclipse is shorter as compared to that of the lunar eclipse, because this one covers the shadow covers a wider area. All right, I'd like to end my lesson by quickly comparing solar eclipse and then lunar eclipse. As I said, it lasts for a shorter period of time, but lunar eclipse, due to the wider nature of the shadows, it is long time. Then the moon is between the sun and the Earth. We have seen that the Earth here, the Earth is also between the sun and then that the moon. And lastly, we have the umbra region being narrow, but here under the lunar eclipse, the umbra region is wider. I'd like to end my lesson today by asking you to subscribe to my channel Academia once again so that you don't miss any lesson from me. We will come your way with the last and final session on the light energy, where we'll talk about reflection and refraction and its application in our daily lives. After that, I'll take a lesson on naming and balancing of chemical